Thank you very much. Welcome to James Randi, Randi's Million Dollar Challenge. Thank you, Randi. Now, I want to point out that we had two claimants, because last year we had a claimant that backed out at the very last minute. We had two claimants this year, one of them backed out at the very last minute. Luckily, we had a backup claimant for this. Now, I also want to point out something else, that we get all kinds of different claims. You tend to probably think that the majority of our claims happen to be just people who claim to have psychic phenomena. But sometimes we work with physical things, like perpetual motion machines, certain specific fuel savers, maybe certain audio cables. And tonight, we are going to be testing something along those lines. So it's not going to be your typical challenge that you are used to. Before we get into that, though, there's a few things that I need you to do. And I really, really need you to do this, please, because normally these type of challenges are not in front of a group of people. The first thing I want you to do is to have respect for our claimant. If you can have respect for our claimant, please. Please, whatever you do, have respect for the claimant. That's really, really important to me. You know, keep your opinions to yourself right now. In other words, if there's something you want to laugh or you might think is silly, please, don't laugh, don't think it's silly. Okay, please, I ask you to do that. From the bottom of my heart, I'm asking you that. The other most important thing is this. Please, put your cell phones on vibrate. Check it. If you're not sure, if you think you've already done it, check it. Make sure that it's on vibrate. We do not want any interferences in here. If you have to leave the room for any particular reason, I will ask you to do it towards the back, and I will ask you to do it very, very quietly. Our claimant is a gentleman by the name of Andrew Needles. Now, Chip, could you get Andrew to come in, please, if you wouldn't mind? I want to point out, this is Chip Denman. Chip is going to be on stage. Yeah, that's fine. Chip is going to be on stage as well. Chip handles all of our statistics whenever it comes to a claim, so thank you, Chip. Chip's, we could not do this without Chip's input on these things as well. I want to point out Jamy Ian Swiss. Jamy Ian Swiss is sort of like my other half, really, when it comes to these things. Could not do it without Jamy as well, and Jamy's going to be on stage as an observer. Chip is also going to be on stage as an observer. I have Matthew Baxter over here. Matthew has been invaluable for this particular claimant, and Matthew is going to be working on the board right there, just keeping track of how well we do. I have Richard Saunders, who brought this claimant to me originally. And Richard's going to be involved. I'm going to be sitting off to the side, sort of observing and running the test, but not touching anything. If anything has to get touched, it will be Richard Saunders that will be doing that. Ryan Bonner, who brought our 12 volunteers, actually 11 volunteers, up on stage. This claimant claims, and if you would read the first line for me, please.
Andrew Needles' claim, in his own words, is as follows. I have created a form of microchip, which he calls the Dynactiv SR chip, that works with and enhances a person's natural energy field, resulting in significantly increased core strength and balance, and is easily demonstrated through the standard kinesiology balance test.
He also states... It's a little further down.
Yes, and he adds, this chip requires no external power source other than a person's own energy field, and it is also his belief that it, quote, emits no frequency other than its own natural capacitive resonance reactance, which is different for each person.
Yeah, so basically this is one of the balance bracelets, and this is Andrew Needles, who's coming up on stage right now. If you'll bring him up, please. This is Brian Bonner, and Brian, if you have a baggie there and it has been in your sight the entire time, your bracelet in there is a placebo bracelet. There's also two boxes that we're going to be using for this test. I'm not going to go through the entire protocol because you will see it as it comes alive on stage for you, so there's no point in me actually doing that. I will point out, and I want to ask you, you have checked over the protocol, you agree with the protocol, correct? And you have signed the protocol. Absolutely. You can step up to the mic if you'd like to. This has not been out of your sight the entire time. You've been watching it. We've kept you in a room, sort of sequestered over there. Yes? Yes? And Brian, you've watched him, and he hasn't gone out of the room, hasn't been anywhere without you watching. Okay? All right. I appreciate that. I am now going to step off to the side because we always, this Randi came up with this years ago, and I think it's very, very fair to all of our claimants. They get to do an open test. In other words, they get to make sure that their product or their claim is actually working under the conditions that they normally try that particular claim. So I will step off to the side over here. If you would hand those to Richard, please. Richard, if you would remove the boxes and if you would remove both bands, and thank you very much. Appreciate it. The darker band is the Dynactiv band, that is Andrew's, and the reddish pinkish band, that is the placebo band. We have one individual that's number 11, and you've worked with every single one of these people. You've made sure that there are no issues, that they can work for this for you. Yes, for your claim to? Perfect. Can I get number 11 to come over and just stand inside of this box right here? Thank you. And if you would just face me. Good. And which band would you like to work with first, Andrew? Placebo band first, all right? So if you'll place that in the box. And Andrew has examined both of these boxes. And in this case, you can actually take it over to the claimant, I mean to the volunteer. And which hand do you want it in? He's going to turn around, of course, facing you in a second. And there, I just want to point out that there is a small line on the side, and that's exactly where the chip falls inside of that box. Would you turn around and face the claimant, please? Thank you. Now the Dynactiv band. Are you satisfied that it's working?
Yes.
Absolutely. We can move on with the actual test itself.
Yes, sir.
Good. And you may be dismissed. You may go back to and have a seat and watch for the rest. Thank you very, very much for helping us. Appreciate it. Thank you. Before we continue, as part of the protocol, I do want to point out that Andrew has agreed that he has to get 17 out of 20 trials. There will be 20 trials, and there will be 17 out of 20 trials that he has to get correct. However, we will be going through all 20 trials, no matter what the result is. In other words, he can get three wrong, but once he gets the fourth one wrong, he understands and he agrees, don't you, Andrew, that at that point you have failed the test or your band has failed the test at that point, but you will continue all the way through after that, right? Yes, okay, good. So can we get, Andrew, if you'll step up to the mic right there for now, if I can get in the... Sorry? Yes. It is expected, just so that you know, that he will get 10 by chance because each trial is a 50-50, as you will see. So what I would like you to do now, Richard, is I want you to take both bands out of the boxes, please. And close the boxes. And what we need to do is randomize those boxes up. So I want you to place one on top of the other and place them inside of the bag. Good. And just give them a good mix. And if you'll take one box out, put it in front of A. And the other box out, place it in front of B. And would you place the Dynactiv band in A, please? And then close the box. Make sure that the chip is against the line. Thank you. And place the placebo in B. Place one on top of the other in any order. Put them in the bag, give them a mix. Take one out, place it in front of A, please. Take the other out and place it in front of B. Good. Well, as volunteer number one, if you'll come over here and just stand Right there. Good. I'd like you to take both boxes again and place them back in the bag, if you will. Just want to make sure they really mix. Give it another mix. And if you'll step over to the volunteer, I'd like you to reach in with your right hand and take one box out, please. And place it in your hand with the line against your palm. Perfect. Put your arms out. Turn around. Face Andrew. There we go. Good. If you'll turn around and face me, please. If you'll step over to 2B and just drop that inside 2B that's on the table, please. Sideways like that. Either way is fine. Yeah. Good. Step over into the box. Reach in the bag again, please. Exact same thing. Place it on the inside. Turn around, face Andrew, step in the box. Thank you. Place that in B. Andrew, are you satisfied at this point? You can try A one more time. Yep. Thank you. Step over in the box, face Andrew. All right, place that, please, back in A. And you may have a seat. Thank you very much. Andrew, at this point, you're going to speak into the microphone. Once you've made your decision, it is final on this round. A was the last one that you did.
Into the mic, please, Andrew.
Into the mic. Yep.
Box A.
Box A. Box A is the target. If you'll remove the tubes, please. And would you open A? Side down, please. Would you open B? The Dynactiv bracelet is in B. The placebo is in A. Baxter, is that a pass or a fail? That is a fail. Okay. Would you do me a favor? Take both bands out of the boxes. You can do it fairly quickly. Yeah. Close both boxes. One on top of the other. Back inside of the bag. Give them a good mix. Remove both. Put one in front of A, one in front of B. And if you'll straighten A out for me, please. Thank you. All right, place the Dynactiv band in either box. Again, with a chip against the line. Yep. And the placebo in the other box. Both boxes on top of each other. Back in the bag, give them a good mix. And if I can get number two to come over and stand over here, please. Thank you. Great, Richard, take the bag over to number two, please. And if you would reach in and take one of the boxes out, place it with the line in your palm, turn around, face Andrew, please. Andrew. All right, turn around, please, if you'll place that in tube A. Thank you. And step over to the box. Reach back in the bag, take the remaining box. Again, line against the inside of the palm, and turn around, face Andrew. Put that in B, please. Thank you. Andrew, are you satisfied?
No, I'm sure. Again.
Which one?
Repeat A.
Repeat A and B. Okay, if you'll take A, please. Put it with a line against your palm. Step back over there. Thank you. If you'll put that back in A, please. And then take B. Again, the line on the inside, thank you. Wants to switch sides? Okay, do me a favor, just stand back by the mic for a second, please. If you'll turn around and face me, would you put the box in your other hand, again, the line on the inside? Thank you, turn back around. Switch sides or switch?
Bands.
Switch bands? All right, if you'll step back over here, please, and if you'll put that back in B, take A out in the same hand that you were just, yep. Make sure that's on the inside of the line, thank you, and step back in the box. All right, if you'll step back and put A back in its box, please. Take B back out. And that's box B, put it back in B, please. Andrew, are you ready?
Yeah.
All right, I'm gonna ask the volunteer to step back and have a seat, if you will. And which one do you believe has the Dynactiv bracelet?
B.
B. And Richard, if you would open up A, please. All right. Put it down, please, and if you'll open up B. The Dynactiv bracelet is in B. Would you mark that as a pass or failure, please? Q. Can I have spectator number 3 step into the box, please? And if you would be so kind as to take the two boxes, just stay right there. Close the boxes. Place one on top of the other in the bag. Give them a good mix. Take them back out. Place one in front of A, one in front of B. And if you'll place the bracelets inside, please. Again, the chip against the line. Good, that's good. And the placebo bracelet in. Thank you. One on top of the other in the bag. Give them a good mix. And if I get you to take your right hand, just reach inside, take one of the boxes out. Take the line, put it on the inside of your palm. Good, turn around, face Andrew. Thank you. All right. You ready? Okay, place that in A, please. Go back to the square. Reach in the bag. Again, put it with the line towards the palm. Turn around. Hands up. Thank you. Put it in B, please. Do you need him to change bands again? Is that it?
Just the choice.
Choice?
Back to A.
Oh, back to A. So if you'll take A out, please. Thank you. Place that back in A, please. You ready, Andrew?
Mm-hmm.
All right, if you'll step back all the way over, hold on. If you'll step back to your seat, please.
Yeah, I want to do B again.
Oh, you want to do B again? Sorry about that. Misunderstanding.
And
get
B.
Back in B, please. Hold on, please. If you'll have a seat. Wait, Baxter. All right, which one do you believe is a Dynactiv bracelet?
B.
Richard, if you would remove the tubes from A, please, and B. Thank you. Dynactiv bracelet is in A. The placebo is in B. Would you mark that as a pass or a fail, please? Thank you. Remove both bracelets from the boxes. Close both boxes. One on top of the other. Put them both in the bag. Remove both, please. One in front of A, one in front of B. Dynactiv bracelet in there, please, and then make sure it's up against the line. Thank you. One on top of the other, place them in the bag. Excellent. Can I get subject number 4 to step on over, please? All right, step on up. Take your right hand, place it in there, take one out. Line against the palm, turn around, face Andrew. right, take that, put it in A, please. Thank you. Can I get you to straighten that out just a little bit so it faces you? Thank you. All right, and if you'll step back over there, reach in. Against the palm, turn around, please. Thank you. Swap sides. All right. You. Place that in B, please. You ready to commit, Andrew? Not yet. You want A? Opposite side. Yep. Thank you. Switch sides. Switch sides, please. All right, if you'll place that back in A, please. Take B out. Which hand would you like it to be in? Put it with the line against your palm, please. Thank you. Try A one more time. Yep. And if you'll put it in your hand before you turn around, please. Thank you. Yep. Thank you. And then step back over there. Thank you. All right, if you'll put that back in there, A, please. Thank you. You ready to commit, Andrew?
Yeah.
Thank you. If you'll go back over there, hold on 1 second, please. So which one do you believe is a Dynactiv bracelet?
A.
You believe it's A? A is the target. And if you remove the tubes, please. Dynactiv bracelet is in A. Would you mark that as a pass or failure, please? Thank you. Remove the bands from the boxes. Close both boxes. One on top of the other. Place them in the bag. Randomize them, please. Remove both. Place one in front of A, one in front of B. And place the bracelets in the boxes, please, making sure that the chip does go against the line. One on top of the other. Back in the bag. Randomize them again, please. And place one in front of A, and one in front of B. If I can get number 5 to come on over, please. And just stand in the box right there. Sorry?
No, sorry.
Yeah, he's got to reach. Yeah, put him in. Mix him again, please. Yep. And if you'll step over there, please. I stay in the square. Yep, thank you. Reach the side, take one out. Put it with a line against your palm. Thank you. And turn around. All right, if you'll put that back in A, please, in the tube. Thank you. Step over to your box over there, please. Face me. Reach inside the bag. Remove the remaining one. Against the palm, please, the line. Turn around. Thank you. All right, if you place that in B, please. Oh, you want to do it again? Okay. Got you. Place that in B, please. Take A, same hand. Palm. That back in A, please. And if you'll take B, place against your palm, and step back over there, please. Which sides, please, to face me, please. Put it in the other hand, against the palm, turn back around. Thank you. If you'll place it back in B, please, take A. And as you're facing this way, please put it against your palm. Step back over there. Thank you. Andrew, from the box, please. Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Which sides? All right, if you turn around and face me, please, and just put it in the other hand, and then turn back around. Thank you. Make sure it's on the lines on the inside. Yeah. Okay. Put it back in A, please. And then take B, same hand, Andrew.
Yes.
Same hander. Make sure the line goes against the palm. Thank you. Step back over there. Thanks. All right, if you all bring that back over, please, place it in B. And if you would have a seat, thank you very much. And the Dynactiv bracelet is in A or B?
B.
B, B is the target. And would you remove the tubes from A and B, please? Let's see. All right, placebo is in A. Dynactiv is in B. Mark if that's a pass or a fail, please. Thank you very much. Remove both bands. Close both boxes. One on top of the other when you're done, please. And then in the bag, you just randomize the boxes up. One in front of A, one in front of B. And place the bands in the respective boxes. Dip in the correct place. Good mix. And I would like number six, if you would please, step on. Okay, step back, please. If you'll take them both out. One of the boxes is not closed properly. Thank you. Yep, randomize the boxes, please. Mix. Take them both out. Correct place. Number six, if you'll step to the square, please. And I'd like you to reach in the bag. Take out one box. Line against the palm. Turn around, face Andrew, please. All right, if you place that in A, please. Reach in the bag. Line against the palm, turn around, please. If you'll put that back in B, please. What does he want to do, Richard? Switch hands or switch boxes?
Switch back
A. Yep. Thank you. If you'll put that back in A, please, take out B. Thank you.
What do you need, Andrew?
What are you doing, Andrew?
What do you need? One by the line. Where the line is in the shape. I can't see it.
Yep. Down the inside, yep.
I couldn't see. I need to check it.
Yeah, we look from this end, and Richard's looking at the same time too. Yeah, we're double checking. Place that back in B, please. Are you ready to commit, Andrew?
Yes, sir.
All right, if you'll have a seat, thank you. And is the Dynactiv bracelet in A or B?
B.
It's in B. And if you would remove the tubes. Dynactiv bracelet is in A. Placebo is in B. You'll mark that, please, as a pass or fail. Thank you. Close both boxes. One on top of the other. And just randomize them, please. Thank you. One in front of A, one in front of B. Make sure it chips against the line. One on top of the other, in the bag, and give them a mix. If I can get number 7 to step on into the box, please. Good. And if you'll take your right hand, reach in the bag, take out the box. Again, make sure it's against the palm, the line. Turn around, face Andrew, please. Thank you. Place that in A, please.
Oh. Change.
Change hands? No, yeah, not yet. Place it in A. Thank you. Step back over there. Face us, reach in. Make sure the line goes against the palm. Turn around, please. Place it in B, please. Wait, are we switching hands or?
Switching hands.
Do me a favor. Yep, switch hands. Make sure the line goes against the palm, please. Yep, and if you'll turn around. Thank you. Put it back in there, please. Same hand, yep. Got it, good. If you'll turn around, face Andrew, please. Yep. Which hands? The other bracelet. If you'll put that back in its respective tube, please. Thank you. Hold on, wait. Yep. Thank you. Richard, just wait till he puts it back in there before you take the other, please. Thank you, yeah. Yep. All right, if you'll put that back in its suit, please. Thank you. Take out A. Again, line against the hand. Face Andrew. You ready to commit, Andrew? Goes back in A.
That was A.
Yeah.
That was A.
That was A, yes. Are you ready to commit?
Yeah.
All right, if you'll have a seat, please. Is the Dynactiv bracelet in A or B?
It's in A.
It's in A. Target is A.
Into the mic.
Into the mic, please, yeah.
A.
A. All right, if you'll open up A, please. And also open up B. Placebo is in A. And the Dynactiv bracelet is in B. And would you mark that as a pass or a failure? And at this point, you do understand that the test has failed, but we agreed that we would go through every trial until we do all 20, correct? Good. If you would please take both boxes, close them, please. And if you'll randomize those, one on top of the other. Good, remove them, one in front of A, one in front of B. Dynactiv bracelet goes in A with a chip against the side, line, yep. Placebo. And can I get number 8 to come stand in the box, please? If you would, place them both in the bag. Give the bag a good mix. Take your right hand, please. Reach in, take out a box. Line against the palm. Turn around, face Andrew, please. If you all place that back in A, please. Step back to the box area there. Face me. Reach in the bag. Take your right hand. Take out the remaining box. Line against the hand, please. And turn around. Thank you. All right, if you put that in B, please. And he wants you to swap out and take A again, please. Same hand. Yep. Mark against pawn, thank you. Step back over there. If you face Andrew. Place that back in A, please. You want it? Step back, face Andrew, please. Put that back in B, please. What does he want to do, Richard?
A again.
Try A again. Same hand? Yep. And if you'll face Andrew, please. If you can put that back in A, please. You ready to commit, Andrew?
Yes, sir.
All right, if you'll go have a seat. Dynactiv bracelet is in A or B?
B.
You believe it's in B? That's the target is B. If you'll open A, please. And if you would open B as well, please. The Dynactiv bracelet is in A. Placebo is in B. Mark it as a pass or a failure. Thank you. All right, both bands out. Close both boxes. And again, one on top of the other. Mix them up. In front of A, one in front of B. And again, please place the band with the chip against the line. Thank you. Mix them up. And if I can get number 9 to come over, please. Step back in the box, please. Thank you. And take your right hand in the bag. Remove one. Make sure the line goes against your hand. All right, turn around. Thank you. You'll place that in A, please. Get back in the square, face me. Bind against the hand. Thank you, turn around. Step back in B, please. Did it switch hands or switch boxes?
Just boxes.
Just boxes. Again, place it with the line on the inside. Thank you. And if you'll step back over there, thank you, and face Andrew. Switch hands if you're face me.
I didn't want to.
Oh, okay. Put that back in A, please. And B, thank you. Line against the palm, thank you. Put that in B, please, in the two. A again. Everybody say their name, please. You ready to commit, Andrew?
Yeah.
Thank you. If you'll have a seat. And the Dynactiv bracelet is in A or B?
B.
You believe it's in B?
You said B, Andrew.
You
correct,
B.
B.
All right, if you'll open A, please. Placebo, and open B, please. Dynactiv bracelet. And mark that as a pass or failure, please. Excellent. Remove the bands. Go ahead. Close the boxes. One on top of the other again. Back in the bag. Give them a good mix. One in front of A, one in front of B. And place the bracelets inside. Again, the chip against the line. Excellent. One on top of the other in the bag. And can I get number 10 to come over, please? And if you would stand in the box. Good. And I am going to need you to reach in the bag with your right hand and remove one of the boxes. Get in the line against your palm. Turn around, please. Thank you. Place that back in, place it in A, please. Thank you. And go back to the box, face me. Reach in with your right hand. Line against the hand. Turn around, face Andrew, please. Thank you. Place that in B, please. Thank you. Put that back in A, please. Let's try the B box again. A again. You gotta make sure the line goes against your palm, please. Place that in A, please. And if you'll take B back over there. All right, place that back in B, please. Ready to commit, Andrew?
Yeah.
All right, if you'll have a seat. And the Dynactiv bracelet is in
B.
It's in B. B is the target. You would open A, please. And also open B. Placebo is in B. The Dynactiv is in A. Mark that as a pass or failing. Give me 1 second, please. I just want to confer here. 1 second. All right. Now, you've agreed to protocol of going through all 20. The choice is, no, that's not, that can't be the reason. Yeah, that's not your concern. Your concern is whether you want to continue or whether you would like to stop at this point.
I'll give you the option at your option to stop.
No,
it's entirely up to you.
All right, and what we will ask you to do is, here's the protocol. We're just going to make a slight notation on that and ask you to sign that, if you would, please. Yeah, Andrew, do you mind taking a few questions?
No.
Yeah, while we do that? So, Brian, are you here? Brian, are you here?
He's here.
If you'll come up, please, real quick. And I'm going to ask, Chip, do you mind, I hate doing this to you,
sure.
Do you mind, like, anybody that has a question taking that to themselves? First of all, I want to thank you very much. I really do. Thank you very, very much for being up here. It's not easy. I guess we'll take a few questions for a few people, but I guess what I'm going to ask you is, what do you think happened, if you don't mind? Just step over to your mic. You can remove the mic from me.
You know, there's a few things. It's never easy, obviously, blind, when you've got, we obviously don't know as far, you get the placebo effect, obviously, but it's also difficult because you have a lot of pressure that's being put on somebody. So when, especially going back and forth and whatnot, there's a lot of placebo in play as far as me doing it on them, as far as the placebo effect on me, trying to test them out and on them. And then it does become interesting as far as that's concerned.
Right.
I'm really trying to feed off what they do and to see how they feel.
Now, when you normally do your bracelets, you say there's a significant difference in it, but there didn't seem to be a significant difference while they were up on stage here. And you did check everybody. I just want to make very clear that you did get a chance to go through and pick people. You eliminated probably about 10 to 12 other people that would not work for you.
Well, the people that we have on stage now were the ones that I felt would respond well on stage. Yeah. But then you also have a couple, well, there's a couple things too. You have people who, and by the way, thank you, everybody.
You guys got a workout.
Part of the problem too is, I mean, we're all on stage. There's nerves for everybody. There is also, when you have that placebo band, for example, you're trying as hard as you could possibly do. And then you get tired as well. So then moving on to the next one, you're trying, it becomes...
And I don't mean to be, you know, I really respect you being up on stage. Doesn't that happen when you're normally using the band and not using a band? Isn't there sort of a placebo effect that could work with that too?
I try to eliminate placebo. I really do. But with respect to this, for example, when I do the boosts and I do the demos and stuff like that, it's always, and as you've all seen, it's with, without, without, with, any order you like. And there's a knowing that this is either supposed to work or it's not. Whether you believe in it or not, you have one choice that this is it, right here. Mm. Trying to play the guessing game is very difficult as far as all the bands are concerned.
But it shouldn't be a guessing game, though, should it? No.
Well, a placebo is a very interesting thing. Mm. It really is. For example, if you tell somebody they can bench press more weight, they probably will.
I will take some questions. I'm not just trying to understand myself of what you're saying there, because I'm not fully sure I fully understand. Because I think by having it blind, you almost get rid of the placebo, because they don't know if they have it or not, right?
No.
I mean, placebo would play more if they knew they had the bracelet.
To be fair, absolutely both. Right. It's on both sides, because in part of the way thing too is, if I'm doing a demo and they have nothing, they know they have nothing, then it's, this is what you are, right then and there. And I've done it, taking it off. I mean, it's interesting, yes, but they don't know, they have nothing on them. So then when they get it, it's whether or not they believe it works. You know, me putting my own effort into it, the placebo effect I'm going to put in. As far as here up on stage, I fully admit, I mean, there's a couple times I flat out, you know, thinking I was right on one, then I go to the other side, or I go back to that one, and I'm changing my mind because of how it felt.
I have one more quick question, because I do want to take questions from the people there, and then we need to get this signed, and we have a few other things we need to do before we leave. So do you believe that your bracelet still works?
Absolutely, and I'll give you the reason why. My first test before I ever came here was as blind as possible, on a bench press, added weight to it, couldn't do it. You know, found out my maximum, added weight so that I could not do it.
Right.
Took different bracelets, put them into a pouch, and when I hit the right pouch, my bench press increased by 20 pounds. That's what the marker was, max plus 20. Over and over and over again, when I hit the right bracelet, I did it. Mm. When I didn't, I couldn't. But there is no placebo effect on the machine. There's only on me whether or not I'm going to be able to do it. And as we all saw, as great as the participants are, there is the excitement. There was a couple times where people would shift. It gets crazier here on stage.
There is another 12 months before you can reapply, but you could, and maybe we could do that, so a test like that instead. Let's take a couple of questions from some people over here, please, if you wouldn't mind.
Yeah, hi. First of all, kudos to Andrew for playing by the rules and agreeing to this thing, which, you know, must be a bit stressful. I have a question about how you're guarding against somebody coming in with an RFID chip on the placebo band and having a Confederate somewhere scanning it so that they know.
Yeah, we went back and forth on this a lot. We actually examined one of his other chips. It was really a huge concern for us, especially with technology. It's something to talk about, you know, that I'm really always concerned about is technology. And so as a result, we really, really, really did guard against that. I'm not going to go into exactly everything that we did right now. There's just not enough time for me to do that, just like there's not time for me to go through the entire protocol and the procedures. But trust me, that is definitely something that we were looking at very, very closely. And it's one of the reasons, like, since 4:30, we've had Andrew under observation very closely, and the people that he has with him are in the back, way in the back over there. So, yeah, but that's a great question. I think Andrew is actually signing a change right now, and then we'll get to your question, please. Yes.
You talk on your website about how the Schumann resonance is what the bracelet affects. Without giving away any trade secrets, does your chip somehow take the Schumann resonance and magnify it physically, or does the circuitry somehow emulate it?
That's where it's inaccurate, sorry. I've actually got three products, two that are on the site. The pendant actually emits Schumann resonance. And that's what you're referring to. The chip that's in the brace is completely passive. It's there, so it's not emitting anything.
Is there any special manufacturing process that goes into the chip, or is the effect basically through the circuitry itself, or is it a physically different chip than a standard watch chip?
Yes, very much. No, I'm not going to tell you, and completely different.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. Next question, please.
I have a two-parter for you. I'm really curious, as I watch you do all this, why aren't you wearing your band?
They won't let me.
No. They wouldn't let him? Okay. And secondly, do you have someone who's performed the test on you? Would have you, like, you know, I would
you
love...
You want the answer on that one?
I'd love to do the test on you.
Check this out. You want the absolute truth, this is the truth, and I love it. Yeah. I've been, every time I go to the mall or the outlet stores, and there's always somebody selling a band.
Yeah.
Every single person said the same thing, I have great balance. Because of what I have on, but before they knew I had it on. So yeah, I've had many people do the demo on me.
And when you have other people do the demo on you, do you find a 50-50 response or do you?
Here's the thing, and this is the absolute truth. The chip that's in it is not gonna work for everybody. It doesn't work for everybody, but it will work for the majority of people that I find. Now,
and you know that it works for you?
I'm saying?
You know that it does work for you?
Yes.
Oh.
But as far as what you're asking, as far as that 50-50 response, that's a 50-50 response based on me, everything I bring to the table, everything they bring to the table at 7:30 at night. It is difficult. I admit that wholeheartedly. But I still came up on stage to do it. But at the end of the day, still, try it out. Let me be the one to tell you, try it out.
Well, what I would like to...
We can't later.
What I'd like to say is, if you're hanging around maybe after or something, I'd like you to put a band on, and I'd like to test it myself and play your role with you if you're interested.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm going to take just the next three questions, if you don't mind. I think you just walked up. Thank you.
I'm just curious if you have any, what special schooling or classes you would take to learn about the Schumann effect and all these other things that you're claiming about your band?
The first part of it is I did what I would want anyone to do on their own. Pick up a book and read. And I mean that wholeheartedly. The number of books I've read are phenomenal with respect to that. The research articles that have been written by whether it be NASA or different universities that have gone through, that's kind of what I went with. And then the studies that I've done using EEG, pulse oximeter, and heart rate, those are all things that I used on top of that. So as far as background and schooling, nothing on this. But there again, pick up a book, read, learn, do all those things. And did I answer the whole thing?
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Andrew. I've seen the applied kinesiology test done on many other types of products. And the one glaring thing that I always see is the product is always put on the person second. And that, from testing we've done, I'm with the Independent Investigations Group in Los Angeles, we've seen that sort of increases your odds to pass if you're the second one. So my question is, have you ever tested it routinely with your product going first and then taking it off and testing second without the product on?
Absolutely, and I definitely agree with you. I'm not a fan of the way people use, or rather abuse, applied kinesiology. The statement of muscle testing, I'm a huge fan of. Bench press, squat, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. As much as I could possibly do, trying to be perfect as I can, but there again, with as many problems as this has, as many placebo effects as there are, as many as the fact that I go back through A, B, go back to A, it becomes difficult. Mm-hmm. Let alone I get tired and I'm not perfect. So I do understand what you're saying. It's not perfect on that whatsoever. But so, yes, I have done the before and afters.
And do you find then when you test the band first and then take it off for the second test, that it changes the results ever, you know?
Not this scenario, the scenario of me not being tired, first of all, having one person, even with a fake band, looking at it, whatever it is, it's, to answer the question, yes. Having it on before, after, every other time, whatever it is, I still get the same results. But it's also a lot more control on my part with one person at one time, looking at differences before and after, setting that motion and that tension the same way, slowly at first, gradually, and not having a big arena of people. So yes, I've had the same results.
I'm going to move on to the next page, if you don't mind, because we're getting low on time here, so thank you.
Yes, you speak a lot about how you are confused by the placebo effect under these conditions, correct?
Correct.
Are you then saying that you cannot differentiate between the effects of your band and the placebo effect?
There's actually more than that, but that's a statement, yes. The placebo effect
Thank
will
you.
Give somebody normally a certain amount of boost in strength or energy, whatever you want to call it, to bench press a certain more weight, whatever it is. The problem actually is if you start adding in that many variables, not just the placebo effect on not knowing which band it is, which is interesting in itself, but being on stage for them, being on stage for me, scorekeeping as you go across, it's a lot of variables that add into it. So you're no longer taking just one placebo effect as in someone doesn't know which band it is. You're taking all sorts of different variables. And honestly, that's what throws me off.
Yeah, I just want to point out one thing that you did agree to that protocol, and it was something you thought that you could do, and you was pretty sure that you would be able to do it. So I just want to point that out. So, you know what? Thank you very, very much. I really appreciate it. And you can't take it. No, you can take it now. Yeah. Had you passed, part of the protocol was that we would actually keep the band ourselves, but you can take it with you. Yeah. All right. Thank you. And again, just that way, I want to thank Baxter and I want to thank Brian as well. Thank you both very, very much. Richard, thank you very much. And Chip, thank you very, very much. And you guys who don't have a seat, because we got something we're going to do real quick. If you don't mind. So yep. Thank you very much. And you may walk out that way with them if you wouldn't mind. So thank you.
And thank you very much to our subjects.
You know I'm going to get rid of them. I want to give them attention.
We could not have done this.
Oh.
So thanks for all your help.
So, yeah, I want to thank all of you. And if you could just follow Baxter that way, I would appreciate that. Thank you all very much. So we also had another applicant, and we had a little bit of a presentation that Baxter and Brian were going to do. We just don't have enough time to do that right here. It's kind of fascinating. We will show that and tease that for maybe next year. And speaking of teasing for next year, we have something else that we want to talk about. Nice little segue there, huh? Which is why you're standing here right now.
I have no idea why I'm standing here now. Except I so enjoy being near you.
Yeah. So at the very beginning, you guys saw the Nightline tests. Yep. That. Now, do you know where we're going? Do you know where we're going now? All right, good. I'll let you go. Just now you know.
Is this on? Yep. Well, we showed you the Nightline story for those of you who may have missed it or would like to see a refresher. Actually, that Nightline did a couple of segments we were involved with. The second segment we were directly involved with that Banachek was in was about. What was the other segment, actually, that wasn't the test, but that was...
There was a segment where they interviewed me about talking to the dead and other psychic phenomena and things like that.
Right, and they also talked about the TV show, the kids psychics.
The kids psychics, yeah.
The focus on that was what was that?
Do you know where you're going with this?
No, because I'm trying to just remind what the other segment was. Anyway, there were two segments about the JREF in the Nightline special, plus another segment about Van Prague that was pretty devastating. In this particular segment that you saw about the Million Dollar Challenge, we did something that we've talked about for a long time but hadn't done before, and that's the interesting distinction that we just want to show to you, which is that in general, in the tradition of the Million Dollar Challenge, claimants come to us, and based entirely on their individual claim, we design a test, a challenge that both sides can agree to is fair. That's exactly what you saw happen tonight, a perfect example. We didn't put anything in front of him that he had to do randomly that was our choice or our idea. We said, what's your claim? And we designed a protocol that everybody agreed to. But in order to provide a different kind of flexibility, when Nightline came to us and wanted to do a test on camera for the million, that was not a preliminary test like this, but actually for the million on the line, we in the subcommittee, including Chip and Banachek and myself, we designed a series of off-the-shelf tests that were seemed to be sort of compatible with the average psychics or mediums, storefront psychic, whatever, claimed abilities, so that instead of them coming and us having to design a specific customized protocol, we would say, well, look, what's your ability? Is it astrology? Is it palm reading? Is it mediumship? Is it tarot card reading? Is it clairvoyance? Which was a really nice one that we didn't get to use. We have these tests ready and waiting. Here's how it would work. You look it over. Do you think this is a fair measure of your ability? And then we take the test for a one shot.
Let me stop you right there real quick, because that's an important thing. In the past, we've always been a little bit afraid of the fact that psychics can always come back and say, well, that's not what I normally do, which is quite often what they say. Even after they've said they can do that,
right.
That is what they normally do. They say, that's not what I normally do. So we've missed many, many opportunities to actually do TV shows because it takes a long time to put that protocol together.
And TV always wants that. Can you test for the million on the camera, make it easy, et cetera?
So we put these off-the-shelf tests together, but we made sure that we had some very specific questions that we asked them ahead of time.
Right, and each time we asked, before they submitted to the test, we asked, and they didn't show this on camera, but we asked, do you think this is a fair test of your ability? Yes. Do you think, how confident are you? Are you confident you could pass this? How confident do you think you are? And invariably everyone would say, very confident, I can pass this. And if there was any hesitation, as a matter of fact, Banachek would then say, well, wait, if you're not confident or if you don't think it's a fair test, no reason for you to take the test, why would you take the test?
We'll work with you and work on a protocol.
Exactly. And so we ended up with this off-the-shelf set of tests that we designed for these various things. And then Nightline advertised to local psychics in New York City. Now, they were going to circulate these flyers to storefront psychics in Manhattan. About, I forget how many they counted, more than 40. And in our lead-up discussions, we all said, they're not going to get anybody. There's no way that people running storefront operations are going to show up.
That's, the majority of those people don't even want the, they don't want the, us kind of
they
people.
They don't want the
skeptics
attention.
To know they exist. They
right. They're there for a different kind of game. They're there to try and get people's life fortunes and so on. So, but what happened was one of those psychics passed the flyer along to a local New Age store. Well, this is interesting because now there's this sort of other class of psychics and mediums and so forth who work within that New Age community, and they tend to be believers, or as in the long time jargon goes, shut eyes, right? People who are sincere. Most people show up for the $1 million challenge invariably, most of the time, more often than not, are sincere. Their intentions don't really matter to us at all in terms of designing the test. But the fact of the matter is that willful frauds don't generally want to be tested. And there are all kinds of things that get tested. Notably, for example, if you look at the dowsing tests that Randi has done over the years, invariably dowsers come in who believe what they're doing is based on the ideomotor response. It's involuntary. They're not aware of it. It's generally not a deliberate manipulation. And these are the kind of people who show up to be tested. So interestingly enough, the circulating through the New Age store, a number of people showed up for the test who had various claimed abilities. And we ended up testing a tarot reader, a palm reader, and several who claimed mediumship.
I think like five people we tested, if I'm not mistaken. It was the people you saw standing there, even though they said there was only three.
Right, and now the mediumship was a real question, because that is one of the most common things in that New Age community that people claim, that people do. They're in touch with mediums, it's talk to the dead, and these are not the superstars like you see on TV who may or may not be deliberately engaging in some kind of deception, but these are people who often have some sincere ability of what they're doing. And so how do you test for that? So the test we designed is actually based on an old magic trick or a mentalist trick that's known as a living and dead test, which was we presented them with envelopes, 12 envelopes, 11 of which had, or actually it was 10 envelopes and it was 12 trials, right?
It was 10
envelopes, 9 of which had photographs of random living persons, and one envelope had a photograph of a dead person, you know, and a famous dead person, just kind of for fun. And we asked them.
And it was always different. Each trial was a different dead person.
Right. It was not the same set every time. So we had different dead people, different live people, et cetera. Lincoln, Elvis, you know, the people you want to talk to. And and then we asked, and I'll tell you, I have to tell you that we all have a back, most of us in the committee have a background in magic. Chip Denman has a background in magic, DJ Grothy. So I remember when you and I brainstormed this test, and then I called Chip and said, okay, how about this? Here's the catalog we've got, and we have this idea to add this one. What do you think of this? And I described this, and Chip went, well, that sounds like a magic trick. And I said, it's only a magic trick when they get it right. So the fact of the matter is that the ones who came in and claimed mediumship, we described the test to them. Here's the idea. Do you think you could do this? Well, it's not for us to explain the mechanism. And they said yes. And they said, you know, they could commune with the spirit, and the spirit would tell them, and whether it was the spirit of the person in the envelope or the photo, or whether it was their spirit guide or whatever that.
They all said it was in the realm of their abilities. They all said they would do well.
Right. So this is the bottom line. This is what we designed these tests, and fortunately we had the support of a pretty skeptical producer. Unfortunately, he was not the only producer, but nevertheless, we had the thing was conceived by a genuinely skeptical producer. Which, when I first heard we had a skeptical producer, I was like, "That's a paranormal claim," because believe me, it wasn't until I got to New York and actually talked to the guy, I went, "Okay, all right, now I believe it." So the point was that he understood what we had to go through, because the TV, it's like, okay, can we just do this once and then get the thing and then go, you know, go. And no, we have many trials we have to do, and this is what it is, and it's our $1 million, not yours.
He's like, can you hurry it up?
Right. Yeah, exactly. Can we hurry this up? No. So anyway, but we had this very interesting afternoon of the Tarot test, the the palm reading test, and several mediums. And what they showed in the final result was not bad. I mean, as television goes for these kind of things, it's certainly the best coverage we've had about the $1 million challenge in quite some years.
And there were some great moments, you know,
and some good moments, and all overall, you know, reasonably fair, but with the understanding that, of course, we know that they're all going to alibi themselves afterwards, and that, unfortunately, with the alibiing, we don't get to see them, each and every one of them, saying, this is a fair test of our ability, and yes, we're going to be successful. So they get to, so now they're all saying, oh, that's not a fair test, it's working with paper, and so on. And the thing about it is, the tarot readers and the palm readers, they're alibiing afterwards, which I don't think we saw much in the show, but they're all alibiing, all had to do with, well, you know, but when I really do this, I'm working with a live subject and we're interacting, and it's like, well, yeah, and why should that make a difference if the tarot cards are telling you, right? If the lines in the hands are telling you, it's make a difference because they're getting all this feedback in a psychic reading, you know?
Yeah.
So.
What Jamy is trying to say.
What's your point?
Very shortly, up on the website, we are going to stick a bunch of these off-the-shelf tests up there for psychics to take, and if they want to take them at TAM, they can.
Well, that was your segue.
That's
that
exactly where we were
segue.
Going.
Well, maybe if I was psychic, I would have known what the hell you were talking about.
Because last year we did talk about this, so yeah.
Yes, and yes, we will post those, and those will be useful tools, and we hope you have a chance to use them again and continue with the $1 million challenge in sort of these two-channel approach, the traditional $1 million challenge of customizing tests to match a claimant's exact claim like this, and on the other hand, these kind of off-the-shelf tests for one shots on the $1 million.
And if we get a lot of them, we may just do a lot of them in another room and do a main one up here. We haven't sorted that part of it out. And then the other thing that we're actually looking at right now is allowing some psychics to actually come here and demonstrate their ability as part of the application process.
Right, because in the preliminary application process, they can just demonstrate. They can show it to us on video and so forth, and we're open to that.
Yeah, it's kind of like the little kidney thing we did last year, where it really wasn't an actual test, basically she was just demonstrating her ability. And that would be part of the application process. If they pass that, then they would actually move on to the preliminary test and then go into a formal test.
I have to say, I think you got a little bit of a nice taste tonight. This particular test, I'm actually pretty happy with how it turned out. And I don't mean by the fact whether it was a pass or fail, but I mean just sort of the procedure, you know, where you're trying to plug all the holes. It's not that we're not worried that there's the paranormal event is going on or the paranormal claim so much as we're worried that maybe we didn't think of something. Maybe we're fallible, we're human. We're trying to figure out, solve the puzzle. Did we create an effective protocol? And as the thing, it's not until the thing starts to unfold in real time that, you know, tonight, I thought, hey, this is pretty good.
I think everything went well. There's a couple of things in my head.
It's a clear demonstration. It looks as fair as it actually is, you know. And I think you got a real sense of kind of what it felt like when we were doing the Nightline test. I'm gonna repeat one quick anecdote. If you were here last year, I already told you this, but I enjoy it so much, I'm gonna tell it again, which is that when we were doing the mediumistic test.
This is something about me, right? It's gotta be.
No, it has nothing to do with, really, it's not about you. And so we're doing the medium test, and let me tell you, this is a stressful day. We're testing five psychics, we're doing repeat trials. It's $1 million on his and my neck. And it was, I've had easier days in my life. And so we're now on the medium test. And of course they have to get they have to get 9 right out of 12 trials. So once they fail 4 times, it's over. And we're just starting the medium test. And I was pretty much an observer. You know, you see I'm hardly on camera because it's pretty much my mission in life to make him famous. And so.
Right there, see what I'm talking about? Right there, could not resist, right there.
So I'm off camera like this, I'm watching all this stuff, and now, you know, she comes out, she does her woo-woo, and they each had a little different thing that they did, and some waved their hands, and some whatever they did. So she does her thing like this, and finally...
There was this...
Yeah, there was that one. Yeah, exactly.
And then
the next trial was
Right. That one,
yes, it was that.
And that was the one that had the excuse that the reason she didn't get Elvis was because Elvis... doesn't like to think that he's dead.
Right. He likes to think of himself, his spirit is alive, he's, you know, yep. Right.
And then on her second trial, it was like, I asked the spirits for a number, and they told me 4. They just didn't tell me that it was, because it ended up being the 4th from the right.
4 from which side?
And she says, it is from, so I said, well, next time you need to ask him from the left or from the right.
He did.
And he
offered, laughing. This was the moment, this was not the story I was going to tell, but this was one of my favorite moments because
I was trying to help.
Beautiful human being that he is, offered the psychic advice on how she was communicating with her spirit. And that was the moment where I kind of went on tilt, off camera. You're doing what? What are you saying? What? But my favorite moment was this thing when it's the first trial, the day, I think, right?
First trial
of what's going to be a long day, but we've had hours of setup and prep and all this stuff, and I mean, it's insane, and getting the TV people to go along with everything and understand everything, oh my God, it's so stressful. And finally, we're ready to go, and she comes out, and she does the thing, and now she says, it's this one.
Very definite. It's this one.
And he opens up the envelope, and she's right. And I watch the blood drain from his face. Okay.
And I'm going,
suspect Jamy. This is how it's going to be. But it's all, we're on camera and everything, and it's serious and respectful, yep. So we're all deadpan. We're just not showing anything. And now we have to sequester the psychic each time to reset for the next trial. So now we take her off and we sequester her in the room and we come back in and I'm like, oh, the look on your face, dude. That was worth the price of the trip to New York, okay? I hope we get 7 more like that.
I told you, see, I told you.
But I'm gonna point out in the context, last important point, in the context of my talk yesterday, that these people...
Wait, which talk?
The one you probably missed because you were doing something important.
It doesn't stop. It's all day. Now you turn on me?
Okay. All right. Yeah.
they're all different than you.
So when you watch these people come up with these explanations, and as they fail more and more, they come up with more and more sort of desperate and creative explanations. The important thing to understand is they're not lying necessarily. They not necessarily feel that they're engaging in any deception. Cognitive dissonance is a known psychological phenomenon. It's not even recently discovered one. We've discovered a lot more about it over the years, but if you ever read a classic book, When Prophecy Failed, fascinating book that you could no longer do that study today because of the tightening of professional ethics, but two anthropologists or sociologists who infiltrated a cargo cult, end of the world cult, in the 50s, and they assumed, and it's the idea that they infiltrated and were undercover for like a year that you could never, social scientists would never do today, and they wanted to wait and see, and when the prophecy failed, they assumed it would destroy the cult, people would fall away, and in fact it didn't, right? And this was this identification of this idea of cognitive dissonance, which, you know, millions of years of evolutionary psychology has, or of evolution and neurobiology, right, has created as a psychological phenomenon. The human being, it's a protective defense mechanism. It helps us survive because we all deal with this, have to deal with dissonances about the real world versus our own idea of ourselves. And that's what you're seeing. It's alive, you know, when we were there, it's alive. Cognitive behavioral experiment to watch people do this. Yeah. And you know, that guy Jesse, we really liked him.
We did.
Sincerely. Yeah. He was so charming and so confident, you know, and our claimant tonight is confident. And you almost, there was a part of us, you almost wanted to see this guy Jesse, like, get it right if it wasn't $1 million on the line. But, you know, because he just was a charming guy who was doing something good and enjoyable and positive. He gets positive feedback about it. And, you know, all his stories, and Banachek gets tipped off, and I understand when towards the end of the test, you can see the guy trying to cover himself, you know,
there's another instance right there, because as you're going to it, he changes and says, yeah. It's a live one, isn't it? So he can get that hit.
Right, and was there...
What you don't see is in one of them, he goes, and I start to open it, and he sees it's a live one, he goes, as if pointing at another one,
if it was one of these two, et cetera. Is that deceptive? Is it willfully deceptive? Yes, maybe it is, but even so, you know, it is this kind of self-protective thing. And what's interesting, what should be interesting to us as skeptics, is not just whether the paranormal claim is real or not, because quite frankly, don't we have a pretty simple, confident answer to that? But what should be interesting to us and what we should be interested in is, why does that happen? How does that happen? Why do people become victims? How do people become victims, right? And understanding that and bringing some empathy to that process. Yeah. And I really, when we ask you to be respectful to these subjects, okay, we're not just asking because we want to be polite. Yes, that's part of it. But we're really, this was Randi, his entire career. If you ever watched him on a TV special dealing with a believer directly or dealing with someone who was sincere, now, I'm not talking about the outright phony con man, okay? Then he was hellfire. But other than that, always respectful, kind, empathetic. It's really important. If you don't get that, I don't think you get what we're really trying to do.
I think as a skeptic, you need to realize that many of these people that do these things or believe in these things are quite often victims themselves. And we can't just go after them and call them the bad guys, because they're not. Many of them are not. Many of them are just simply self-deceived, at least from my perspective. So, yeah. Buddy, I love you.
Thanks for coming. I hope this was a suitable ending for you. Finale to TAM 2012. Come back next year. We'll try and give away $1 million again. Thanks.
Thank you.